number of people in America who are killed by lightning each year is surprisingly small. It is not 250,000, not 100,000, not 10,000, nor even 1,000, but 50. As causes of death go, lightning is statistically negligible. Though, of course, that is of little comfort to heartbroken loved ones left behind. When I say that the low death toll is surprising, it's because the number of lightning bolts that strike American soil each year is about 20 million. And the number of people who are exposed to the risk they pose is all of us in America, about 1/3 of a billion. In a population that size, surely the odds of ending up on the wrong end of a lightning bolt must be greater than 50 out of however many. The low statistic is probably a tribute to how careful we all are to seek the safety and shelter of a building or a car until the storm has passed. Thankfully, we're not idiots. Yet it is also true that lightning isn't necessarily always lethal. In fact, 9 out of 10 victims live to tell the tale. Those who survive a direct hit may recover within weeks, or they may suffer the ill effects for life. Either way, they tend to seek each other's company. They get together in national or regional meetings and exchange experiences. There's even a worldwide organization of survivors. It's called, and now I must pause to take a breath, Lightning Strike and Electric Shock Survivors International. Let me take another breath for the acronym. LS and ESSI. And what a cute logo, by the way. Why, you may ask, would lightning survivors set up an international organization? Part of the answer is that the symptoms of severe electric shock are so unpredictable and so strange. People around you don't always respond well. I'm not talking now of headaches or forgetfulness, though these are bad enough. Truly strange symptoms include losing the ability to feel cold, changes in personality that creep the hell out of your loved ones, dissociation, that is, the feeling that your body is not you, but a strange entity that you happen to control. The rarest symptom of all is the sudden awakening of exceptional musicianship, of a particularly intense kind. We will look at a case of this in a few moments. Now, why would strange and unpredictable symptoms occur after a lightning strike in particular? It has to do with the central nervous system. It operates by electric signals, tiny electric charges that are constantly being fired from one nerve cell to another. By the way, there is something really useful about these electric charges. They can be detected with MRI scanners and visualized on 2D or 3D models of the brain. This allows us to tell what parts of the brain are being engaged in what sorts of activities. In simple terms, you can ask a subject to do something, take an MRI scan at the same time, and the area that springs into action will reveal heightened electric activity. This is true also of musical activity, as we will see later in this lecture. But right now the point is this: a nervous system that operates with tiny electric charges is going to be severely disrupted by a lightning strike of 1 billion volts. There is certain to be damage. And the bad news is that the nervous system is not good at repairing cells or growing new ones. What it will do, and what it's really good at, is developing workarounds with the hardware it already has. You just get other cells to do what the damaged cells no longer can. The ability of the nervous system to reassign tasks in this way is spectacular. Think only of this. There is a medical procedure called hemispherectomy. It's named after those symmetrical halves of the brain called hemispheres. The procedure consists in the surgical removal of one complete hemisphere. Sometimes that is the last medical resort, for example, in cases of severe epilepsy or rapidly spreading tumors. The marvel is that the procedure is not going to turn you into a zombie, far from it. A human can live and function with either the left or the right half of the brain alone. It almost makes you wonder why you needed the other. Actually, hemispheres may be symmetrical, but they're not duplicates. It has been observed early on, and it is still popular wisdom today, that the left and right hemispheres are in some way different minds. While the left hemisphere is said to be logical, rational, analytical, word and number oriented, precise, and likes to put things in orderly rows, the right hemisphere is often seen as flamboyant, colorful, artistic, and filled with a zest for life. This difference between the two hemispheres is called lateralization, by the way. It's in your syllabus. Music tends to be associated with the right hemisphere, though people who work on music professionally tend to need more and more of the left hemisphere to do their job properly. Maybe that too is a workaround. And yet, workarounds tend to come at a price. They exact it in the form of symptoms. And since the nervous system controls just about everything in the human body, the symptoms can turn up in the strangest of places. This gets us to the curious case of Dr. Tony Chicoria, an orthopedic surgeon living in upstate New York. 26 years ago, he was hit by a lightning strike that would change his life forever. It happened here by a lakeside pavilion on the shore of Sleepy Hollow Lake, Athens, New York. One afternoon in 1994, Tony was having a good time at a barbecue organized by his friends. And suddenly he remembered that he was going to call his mother. Now, this is 1994, the dark ages when people lived their blighted lives without cell phones. I still remember those times and sometimes wonder how I could have even felt happy. Fortunately, there were payphones everywhere, and Tony found one around the corner. He let the phone ring a couple of times, but his mother did not pick up. Oh well, he thought, I'll try again later. In the meantime, he noticed, half absently, that there were clouds gathering in the distance. It looked like there might well be rain within the next hour. Unfortunately, the insidious thing about lightning is that it often strikes when you thought the electrical storm was still some way off. That's what happened with Tony at the precise moment he put back the receiver. There's a long blank, then hazy memories of confusion and disorientation. Where am I? Where was I? Why are these people looking at me? The ambulance was already on its way, but by the time it got there, it was no longer needed. Tony had returned to full awareness so quickly and was feeling so much like his old self again that he felt ready to drive himself home. Next morning, his physician congratulated him. Not only had Tony survived, but there was no sign of permanent damage. The only thing the doctor could advise was to take it easy for a while. Everything went fine for about 2 weeks. And then Tony sensed that something strange was going on. He felt the awakening of a feeling he had never had before. Let's hear it from Tony himself.
And it was within 2 weeks of that injury that is when things started to change. And at that point, I started having this insatiable desire to hear piano music, which was a big departure for me. I grew up as a kid of the 60s. There was rock and roll, and there really wasn't much else. So all of a sudden, I've got this interest to hear classical piano music, and it was pretty strange. Mm. But it was so strong that I actually drove to Albany, because nobody around here had that kind of music. And so I bought a CD of favorite Chopin by Vladimir Ashkenazi, and I was absolutely smitten with it. I listened to it all day long, all night long, made my friends listen to it, made them listen to it at work. I think they hated it. But, you know, to me, it just wasn't anything better. Right. And within a period of weeks after that, I just wanted to be able to learn how to play. Mm. But I specifically wanted to learn how to play that stuff. Mm-hmm. I was absolutely possessed and obsessed, and I thought that the music was the only reason that I was still here.
Well, Once Tony had bought his grand piano, he practiced endlessly, day after day, in a state of possession so all-consuming that he scarcely even noticed that it was taking a toll on his marriage. All he could think of was music, music, music. Now the music even came from within him. Melodies, chord changes, outlines of whole pieces. He needed to write it all down somehow. And once he had learned to do that, he began to accumulate a repertory of works. At age 45, Tony had become a composer. Look at the cover of his first CD, a place of honor for the lightning strike, not as a calamity, but as the source of his musical power. Let's hear a clip of Tony's Rhapsody in D minor, Opus 3. I first learned of Tony Chicoria and his newfound musical passion from a book by the famous neurologist and author Oliver Sacks. It came out in 2007 and is called Musicophilia. It's a terrific read, full of strange and thought-provoking real-life stories about the brain and music. Yet the word musicophilia applies only to the story of Tony Chicoria. Sacks used it as a kind of a clinical term, denoting a love of music so intense and so obsessive as to seem well-nigh pathological. There's no question that Tony's case had to do with the functioning of the brain. Perhaps the workaround, the restructuring of nerve cell connections, had the unintended but fortuitous effect of creating new possibilities elsewhere. You could even argue that his newfound passion for music had more to do with his brain than with the music he loved. After all, he had heard the same music before, and then it left him relatively unmoved. Now, on the other hand, it felt that music was at the core of his being. So, what it takes to develop exceptional musicality, or so it would seem, is a bolt of lightning followed by 2 weeks of neural recovery. If only that experiment could be replicated. The opposite of musicophilia also exists, and it is called amusia. Here's an image from the Memorize course I've created for Music 103, a man straining to hear any kind of sense in what his ears tell him is random noise. We speak of amusia when the brain lacks the tools to recognize sounds as musical, or even to conceive of such a thing as music. I once heard that one of our former queens in the Netherlands, I'm a Dutchman by the way, Wilhelmina, was born with amusia. At public ceremonies, she had to be reminded to stand up when the national anthem was playing. It is not that she couldn't recognize this particular tune or mistook it for another. She heard everything fine, but couldn't tell there was music playing. Here is how Oliver Sacks, the author of Musicophilia, explains amusia in an interview.
There's something which is very rare where there is a total inability to perceive music as music. People speak here of amusia, of congenital amusia. Sometimes amusia can occur from a brain injury or a tumor. Sometimes one may be born with it. People like this really can't tell one tune from another. In fact, fairly recently, I've had a chance to talk to a delightful, intelligent woman who has this condition. She describes how, as a child, she came from a rather musical family. She couldn't recognize any tune. She couldn't distinguish tunes. you know, her boyfriends would like to take her to concerts, and she would say yes, but she was partly bored and partly excruciated. I said, why excruciated? You know, what did it sound like to you? She said, you want to know what it sounds like? She says, when you play what you call music, she says, to me it sounds like the rattling of pots and pans. If you went into the kitchen and you threw all the pots and pans on the floor, it's noise.
Well, the rattling of pots and pans is perhaps not the most helpful analogy. No amount of amusia is going to transform piano music into the sound of cookware being tossed in the tumble dryer. Amusia is more like the opposite. It doesn't transform sounds at all. That is precisely the problem. It allows the signals that enter the ear to go directly to consciousness, unfiltered and undigested. The brain simply doesn't know what to do with them. It cannot attribute significance to things that we hear and distinguish as pitch, rhythm, volume, or tempo. And so it cannot put together a coherent experience for consciousness to appreciate. When a person with amusia hears a piano piece, it won't sound like pots and pans, but rather as a wash of artificially produced noise in which nothing stands out as meaningful. Something like this. Whereas the brain of people without amusia will do a lot of work to pre-digest the sound input, polish it up a bit, and put together an experience so self-evidently musical that we can't even imagine someone not hearing it like we do. Here's that same piano piece, but now heard through the correcting filters of the human brain. Music does indeed seem unique to the human brain in particular, just like language is. It's an evolutionary adaptation that emerged long after Homo sapiens had parted ways from other primate species. In the next lecture, I will discuss the earliest known evidence of musical activity among humans. It dates from a mere 40,000 years ago. In evolutionary terms, that is so recent that you cannot even mark it on a timeline like this, which is reckoned in millions of years, without marking our own time as well. Within our own species and our own culture, we can instantly tell if someone else is affected by music. It's like we just know it. Except we're often wrong. Associating facial expression with musical expression is something we cannot help doing. Just show a facial expression and play music at the same time, and the immediate assumption is that the person is affected by the music, and the music tells us something about her. This makes us vulnerable to manipulation, especially in movies. In the letter scene of the first Guardians of the Galaxy movie, Peter Quill receives a belated gift from his mother, who has died long ago. A letter and a tape of Awesome Mix Volume 2. He plays it, and instantly the camera zooms in on his face. He is thinking about his mother, and the music brings back all those memories. Now, the letter scene is one of several clips I modified for Music 103 by replacing Peter Quill's Awesome Mix item by one of ours. The new track, it turns out, works just as well, maybe even better, even though now we cannot guess what exactly he is thinking of. The reason why we cannot help making an association between a face and the music here at the same time, even when we know there cannot be an association, is that the brain makes a number of decisions when it evaluates the input from the eyes and ears. When we are looking at something neutral, like say the inside of a car engine, the brain will give us just the sounds. But when we see a facial expression, it will throw in that sight into the package of musical experience it is preparing for us. A good example of this is the internet sensation of Emotional Baby back in 2013. It was a video clip of a mother singing to her 10-month-old daughter. The song was a sad one, or at least it has sad lyrics. It's My Heart Can't Tell You No by Rod Stewart, about loving someone who is in love with somebody else. Now, I must tell you, never have I seen a human being so profoundly moved by this song and showing such apparent understanding of the song's emotional nuances. Emotional Baby is not feigning. She genuinely seems to feel the heartache. Judge for yourself.
I don't want you to come around here no more. I beg you for mercy. You don't know how strong my weakness is or how much it hurts me. 'Cause when you say it's over with her, I want to believe it's true. So I let you in, knowing tomorrow I'm gonna wake up missing you, wake up missing you, when the one you love's in love with someone else.
When I first saw this clip, I knew it looked too good to be true. 10 months is not the developmental stage at which the first signs of musicality are detected. For that, one might have to wait at least another 10 months. And the signs of musicality would be rather different from these. So I felt certain there had to be another explanation. Having changed a fair number of diapers as a young father a long time ago, my first thought was that perhaps Emotional Baby was having a bowel movement. That can be a visibly emotional experience for infants, and indeed can bring tears to their eyes. But no, I watched again. Emotional Baby really did seem to respond to the music. As soon as her mother paused at the end of one line and took a breath for the next, her face would light up and she would smile expectantly, as if the silence had brought new hope of a snack or a hug. Then, when the next line started, the sadness would spread all over her face again, and the tears would well up in abundance. How extraordinary! It was impossible to watch the clip and not be convinced that it was the music and nothing but the music that did this. Then the internet sensation came to national attention. Emotional Baby was flown over all the way from Toronto to California and appeared live before a national audience in the Ellen DeGeneres Show. The experiment was repeated right there and then, yet the results this time were different. Judge for yourself in the following clip.
I want to believe it's true, so I let you in, knowing tomorrow I'm gonna wake up missing you, wake up missing you, when the one you love's in love with someone else.
Well, that solves at least one problem. The problem that remains is why so many people, myself included, could not help but see an exceptionally delicate musical sensibility in this little infant. The brain must have been playing tricks on us. But it has good reasons for doing so, for when musical experience includes an expressive face, it will become that much more intensive. When Emotional Baby was in her cot at home, We heard a song about heartache, and we saw an infant who seemed to feel it. But when she was in the studio, we heard a song that tried and failed to get a baby to cry. You may be wondering about the person you see right before you right now, who is clearly in a state of emotional agitation. The image comes from a video clip that looks like pure insanity, at least if you silence the music. Here's a sample. Certainly, this is an expressive face, and I could be persuaded that it may be moving in sync with some piece of music. It could hardly make any sense otherwise. But I would be persuaded only objectively. I don't respond musically to the silent video because I can't tell what the music is. My best guess would be Bohemian Rhapsody by Queen. But as it turns out, the music is a violin concerto by Paganini, composed a little over two centuries ago, in the 1810s. If I heard it before, it can only have been by accident, and I would probably have turned it off fairly soon. Paganini composed a concerto to showcase his unparalleled virtuosity on the violin. So you'll be hearing lots of pyrotechnics and acrobatics, scales and leaps rapidly flying up and down the pitch range of the instrument. Meanwhile, the orchestral style is that of the Italian opera, like Rossini. It has always struck me as kitschy with those cymbal clashes. Bang, bang, bang. Here's an example. So, now we have seen the face of silent madness, and we've heard the operatic sound of the 1810s. It's time to allow the brain to put them together into a musical experience that might be more than the sum of its parts. Will we still see the face of a madman? And will we still hear the empty technical display of the violin? Let's have a look. To me, the result is extraordinary. The facial expression and the musical sound have merged into one, more powerful than either in isolation. There's a range of recognizable emotions, rapid mood shifts. The marvel is that we don't even know what the emotions might be about. You cannot accomplish all this in words. They would have to be about something. Whereas this conveys stirrings of the soul regardless of what might have provoked them. So how does the brain do all these things for us? And where in particular does it do them? I say, let's open up a skull. And what skull could be better suited for our purposes than that of the great Johann Sebastian Bach himself? It was unearthed more than 100 years ago in the cemetery where we know from documents that he was buried. The outside of the skull has served as the basis for facial reconstructions like the one you see in the background. Here is a more recent effort. But of course it's the inside that concerns us. So let's now turn to an interior cast of the skull. And here it is, a plaster cast. Welcome to the brain of Johann Sebastian Bach. Let's get straight to business. The human brain consists of various major sections, but the one that concerns us here is the temporal lobe. It's called temporal because of its proximity to the temples of the skull. You'll notice that it's also situated right above the ear. We find a mirror image of this situation on the other side in the left hemisphere. Broadly speaking, the temporal lobe is associated with input from the external senses, especially hearing and vision. The part of it that is concerned with sound is called the auditory cortex. This part doesn't do quite all the work that is needed for a coherent musical experience. It's simply the first part of the brain where signals from the ear are being welcomed. And it makes the first decisions. This is music, this is speech, that is mechanical noise, those are sounds of the environment, and so on. We can examine the way the auditory cortex does its job by the method I mentioned earlier, the MRI scan. Here's an example of the kind of image it produces. This particular brain is not representative. More intelligent individuals would not typically have such a pronounced Swiss cheese aspect. Nor would they have a brain of such modest dimensions that it could almost swim around in the brain fluid. But it's the only image I could find. Here is a recent article about the auditory cortex, published only 7 years ago. The findings are fascinating. The research team wanted to find out more about the distinction between music and speech. We know that the brain makes that distinction, but could MRI scans confirm that it does and where it happens? To answer that question, the team assembled a collection of 165 sound samples, including many samples of speech and music, but also other sounds of many different kinds. Having prepared this collection, the next step was to feed those sound samples to test subjects in an MRI scanner and register what part of the auditory cortex was activated by what kinds of sounds. The results were compelling. Here are two images of the same auditory cortex, but responding to different kinds of sounds. The yellow color represents electric activity, and the dark blue color stands for neurons at rest. It's almost too good to be true, but it does appear that the processing of speech engages a discrete and well-defined area of the auditory cortex. But when you look at that same area in the second image, when the brain is dealing with music, a sizable part of it has turned dark blue, indicating that it plays no part in this activity. From the evidence of this second image, musical sounds seem to be steered to another well-defined area, which now lights up bright yellow. And yet, when the brain is dealing with speech once again, this musical area turns out to be dark blue, signifying inactivity. Are these results exciting? Well, let me put it like this. We like to argue about what is music and what isn't, and we like to think that it's up to us to decide. That makes sense. For if we can't decide the question, then who can? And yet it looks from these results that the brain has already decided the question for us long before we get to hear anything. This underlines the point I made earlier about amusia. Amusia is when what happens when the brain does not decide the question for us, and in fact doesn't even know that there is a question to decide. For such a brain, music doesn't even exist in theory. It would be interesting to explore the question how the brain knows what is music and what is speech. One answer might be that the knowledge was there already at birth, at least in potential. That it's in the wiring of the human brain altogether. The opposite answer might be that the brain has no such knowledge at all at birth and develops the wiring in the course of a lifetime of speaking and experiencing music. In that case, our sense of music is not universal, but the reflection of our lives and the cultures we live in. I'm going to leave that question open for now. Now let's look at some other things that have been discovered about the auditory cortex. The images you see before you map brain activity in two situations: when you are hearing sound and when you imagine that you are hearing sound. When the experience has to be imagined, there are only faint traces of activity in the auditory cortex. But the fact that it is engaged at all suggests something important. The decision-making process is needed not just when signals are coming in from the ear, but even when they are dreamed up by the imagination. It's like the auditory cortex is the one place that knows what sounds are musical, whether they are heard or imagined. So the odd thing is that you can have a musical experience without audible sound. In fact, you can have a musical experience without the help of the ears altogether. People with hearing disability can go to a concert and hear the music with the help of a balloon held in their hands. It may make a curious sight, like in this image taken in the Netherlands. And yet it makes perfect sense. The balloon is a membrane that can pick up vibrations in the air. The hands do the job of picking up those vibrations, and then it's for the brain to decide what part of them might be musical. That is exactly how the ears work. The actual hearing is done at the end of a long tube deep within the skull. This is where we find the middle ear. And what's going on there is a direct equivalent of hands holding a balloon. The membrane, in this case, is the eardrum. It's absolutely tiny, but it's capable of picking up vibrations in a vast range of frequencies. The hands, the 10 fingertips, is that tiny hammer-shaped bone holding the eardrum. It turns the vibrations into motions that can be passed on. In the first instance, they are passed on to the even tinier bone called the stirrup. From there, they will make their way to the auditory cortex. In purely mechanical terms, there is no difference between the two processes. And yet, it is not easy to be persuaded that a balloon can offer the same musical experience as the ear. Or at least that's what a hearing person would say. Just try to hold a balloon in a concert hall. Chances are that you feel barely anything at all, let alone the sound of music. But this is just taking your own life for granted as the norm for everything else. Hearing people rely on the ear for their musical experiences. Yet there is nothing inherently musical about the workings of the ear. We have learned that today. It's not the ear that gets to make the decision as to what is music and what isn't. That decision is made higher up, in the auditory cortex. It can make that decision regardless of where vibrations are coming from, the ear or the hand. It is true that the auditory cortex is not typically involved in sensations of the hand. This explains why the balloon and the hands cannot offer a musical experience to hearing persons. But a person without hearing would obviously benefit if the signals from the hand could be routed to the auditory cortex and processed there as music. If only if there were a way to get the brain to do that. But that reminds us. The nervous system is an expert at doing just that, rerouting signals to other parts of the brain, calling on those parts to take on new tasks. That is exactly the kind of workaround it will come up with after an injury. If it won't do that for the hearing, it must be because their ears are working just fine. All this is not a thought experiment. There is recent research which shows a telling difference between people who have the ability to hear and those who don't. Those who don't are compensated for it by a neural adaptation. I learned of this research from a website which proudly announces the following result, and I quote, "Study indicates deaf people sense vibrations in the auditory cortex." The website didn't provide any details, so for the purposes of this lecture, I wrote to the project director, Dean Shibato, and asked if he would be willing to share his MRI images with us. He did. So now we can take a brief look at his discovery and how he made it. First of all, he took not one image of the brain, but nine, at regular intervals, going from top to bottom. The first image shows only a small section of the brain. Yet the cross sections will grow with each new image, all the way down to the brainstem. Nine altogether. The point about this layered look is that one can directly compare separate areas of the brain residing at different places. One of these is the auditory cortex. The other is an area further up, which deals with sensory input from the hands. When the hearing person is holding a balloon, the signals will go to this hand area. They're not useful anywhere else. The question is whether this is true also of a person with a hearing disability. Let's look at the results. Here are nine successive slices of one and the same brain. It is at rest. We don't see the brightly colored electric activity that would indicate the processing of sensory input. But now let's play some sound. Since this is the brain of a hearing person, it will process the sound exactly where we know it will, in the auditory cortex. That's fairly low down in slices 7 and 8. Now let's ask that same person to hold a vibrating object in its hands, like say a guitar when plucked. Once again, the signals go exactly where they should, the hand area. They show up in two slices near the top of the head, numbers 2 and 3, in the area dedicated to the hand. The auditory cortex is not involved at all. But now comes the critical slide. What happens in the brain of a person who is hearing disabled? What if they were asked to touch or hold a vibrating object? The cross-section images show a complex picture. We see varying amounts of activity on various levels. But here is the crucial discovery. The area that lights up the most, in slices 6 and 7, is the auditory cortex. This is the image of a true workaround. The hearing person on the right does not need the auditory cortex for vibration coming in from the hands, and so we don't see that area light up. But the hearing disabled person on the left does need it for that purpose, and the auditory cortex happily obliges. Somewhere in the brain, the decision has been made that what the hands feel is sometimes usefully interpreted as sound. Okay, so what is the upshot of all this? Let's have a quick recap. We can learn about music by looking at those parts of the brain that are devoted to processing sound. The single most important part is the auditory cortex. It deals with everything that is. It has different regions for the processing of speech and music. So the auditory cortex knows what sorts of sounds are musical. The auditory cortex can be musically active even when we're not hearing sound. For example, when we're imagining a piece of music without hearing it. Or when we're plagued by an earworm. This can also happen when hearing impaired individuals sense vibrations in their hands. A balloon can then be effective as a kind of eardrum. It vibrates with the sound. The hand picks up the vibration. Even when we hear music, when we hear musical sound, there are many other things that make the musical experience what it is. For example, a face that communicates a variety of emotions. But if musical experience can embrace all of these things, vibrations felt in a balloon, tunes heard only in the minds, facial expressions, and much else that doesn't involve sound, then what is music? We will leave that question for another lecture. To be continued.